what can I do to take my next step in terms of building more value for my customer? Okay, you don't have enough cash. You are not getting printed. There are hundreds of customers waiting outside. How do you make their life less distressing?
Right.
What can you do? Should you open up a night pack? Should you open up? Should you make restricted timing ATMs? And should you then give an ATM pass that you come at this time, here your 500 customers, to 100 customers, between 9 and 11 you come. Next 100, whatever, I'm just making it up. Have the banks thought about way out? They haven't. So the next level of relationship building that was possible in this crisis, and the bank who could have done it would have taken away customers from the neighboring banks. The question nobody thought. So that is exactly what is happening. So what they are saying is that customer relationship is perhaps today a company's long-term asset. It is not a short-term service anymore. You have to value it and invest in it, and you have to build this asset which will become, and I'm sure in the next 10 to 15 years there will be a valuation of customer relationship.
Valuation?
Yes. We are heading towards that.
Valuation of a customer, and how will that like?
See, there is something called already we know goodwill of a company is valued. That has been happening. How is goodwill value? Goodwill is a combination of hardware and software. What is software here? Software is people's opinion about the company. And hardware is the physical assets that the company has. Now this goodwill is translated in marketing as something called brand equity. What is brand equity? Brand equity is the sum total of the brand experience. That means I have traveled with IndiGo. What is my opinion about IndiGo? So if I am asked which airline do you prefer traveling in India, if I say IndiGo first, that means IndiGo's brand equity is the highest among the airlines. Today they are trying to value that.
But how you are converting that to monetary?
There is a calculation which is used to do that. I'll give you an example. Let's take Coca-Cola. Coca-Cola's, and I'm quoting some old figures, not current figures. These will be 5-6 year old figures. Say Coca-Cola's assets, meaning their plant, their machinery, warehouses, all that together, would be about say 50 or billion. 50 or billion or trillion, I'm misquoting, whatever, 50 or billion. But the value of that name, Coca-Cola, is 70 million. Which means it is 20 billion more than the hardware that the company has. Mm-hmm. So today, if they sold all their hardware and retained the name Coca-Cola, they would have got 50 million or less. Mm-hmm. But if they didn't sell their hardware and sold only that little name called Coca-Cola, what side you do? What is that? That is the equity that the that eight letters commands in the marketplace.
No, the valuation of the company is a consist of hardware and software. Hardware is the assets of the company. Right.
Hardware is
the assets of the company. And software is the opinion of the customers or
So if they sold only their software, should we?
Then
they get 70 million.
70 million, okay. And hardware won't cost us 50 million.
Their valuation is 50. If they sell it, they'll obviously not get 50, they'll get lower than 50.
Right.
my current valuation is 50. It has only there about
30. Right.
But this is going up. The 70 quotient is going up. The hardware quotient is going down. No. Because they have depreciation and other things that are
added. Yes, yes.
So this is an appreciating asset. And what has it come from? Relationships. What Coca-Cola has made me feel, made you feel, made us feel.
Feelings or whatever. Quality.
That is relationship.
A lot of parameters are there.
So this is what is unique about customer relationship. And this is constantly, and this is one of the dynamic efforts and issues in the whole marketing infrastructure. Everything else is more or less predictive. Meaning, if I market, if I do a campaign, I can calculate how many customers I need to reach, what is the cost I can reach the customers, I can calculate what percentage of the total people reached are likely to convert, how many of the total people reached are users of my product, how many are non-users of my product. There's a rough calculation to say if I put out my campaign, how many of that total base would possibly recall my campaign and how many conversions am I likely to get. So I can calculate my impact on sales. This is where the multiplier effect comes. And this is what actually will push my sales up. So I will spend lower, I will earn more. If you have noticed, Indigo advertises far less than it used to when it came in. Why have they been able to do that? They have larger number of customers now than they used to have them. And they managed to find better solutions for customer relations, through customer relations. Their customers are talking to each other. This lesser necessity of Indigo to talk to them. This is where the game is, a lot of the game today is won and lost. So it's obvious, 1980s onwards, there's a time. See, there's a time when brands spoke and people listened. I said, I am Coca-Cola, I'm giving you this drink, which is like in color, sweet to taste. I think you like it. People used to believe what they were told. As time passed and as you can see, started from the 80s, people have become far more discerning because choice has gone up. I have a lot to choose from. Our biggest difficulty today is when we decide to buy a certain product, the biggest difficulty is to choose which one we like. Today you want to buy an automobile, you want to buy a mobile, you want to buy a watch, you want to buy your spectacles, you want to buy your clothes, which brand will you buy? Which TV will you buy for your house? And what do we end up doing? We do a lot of research. We go on to the net, today we have got data, and from the 1980s, data has been in everybody's hands. We search, and we confuse the daylights out of ourselves. Then we talk to our friends, who in turn confuse us even more. And by the time we reach a stage where we spent a month and a half doing nothing about procuring that product. And then finally we go to the shop and the salesman convinces us. But the fact is, people have begun to make a choice. Today if you look at people in their 20s, they know which what they want. It's we guys who get confused. They know which watch they want. They will never go to a shop to buy.
Online.
Price. Why do we go to a shop and buy? We believe online they give us a spurious product. But we forget that online portal also has a reputation to maintain like the shop. And backends have been created in the country for portals who are large distributors. Amazon has setups across the world and they are large distributors of such goods and products. Now, this rapid shift has really shaken up marketing. And what is happening as a result of so many choices? There is more supply, less demand. Every category we today look at, there is much more supply than there is demand. I want to buy one. Every 6 months, they try to make me buy that same product. Here the products don't last long enough. Longevity is reduced. I have to change. They make sure that I have to change my television set every 6 months. Because they're constantly bombarding me or introducing new technology of broadcasting so that you need to change your television set. So they're hanging me in from all sides. And when I'm about to change, that's when the confusion begins. So it's a funny situation that exists. But this funny situation also means that there is tremendous price competition. Today, if I go to buy my TV, I know online I get so much off. I go to Great Eastern, I get Express. I have figured out what to do. So the seller is no longer controlling the price. It is the buyer who is beginning to control the price. So that's another funny thing that is. So how do you get more price out of the buyer? Again, your example. 500 rupee difference in the airline ticket. And IndiGo is succeeding because of the relationship that they have built up. Only protection today is relationships. There is no other protection. So organizations are forced to become, enforced to become. Today if we look at Samsung, we look at LG, look at any of them, look at Sony, look at anybody, look at the pains they are taking to convince us. If I go to a Samsung outlet today, there are so many products I don't know what I want. I want to buy a tab, I might end up buying a mobile phone. So many choices. Because somebody is there telling me that this is good for me, they are creating an atmosphere where I am wanting to know more about the products. I may not buy the day I go to the store, but I'll come back and I'll start checking on the internet. I'll start comparing. Then I'll see this guy say, then I'll go back and say, okay, you told me this 150 rupees. Can you give it to me for 120 rupees? I'm exaggerating, but we do that. And sometimes we find that they give us that concession. I'll tell them I'm getting it at the internet for 120 rupees. Why do I buy it for 120? That poor guy has to sell his product. So the customer focus is becoming very large. And it is becoming very large because people have begun to understand the mindset of the consumer. That he is going to go and do this. So let me create a pricing that allows him to do this. We must not think those guys are not making money. They are all making money. But they are making us feel that we are dictating. That is the game changing that has happened, and has happened because of the relationship building that we need to do. So what is therefore the companies are doing is they are going out in the market, going to the consumer, and finding out all these things from the consumers themselves. One is the company consists of people. The marketing people, the other people in the company, they're all like us, they're people like us. Their behavior, their own behavior has changed because they're also consumers, not of their own company's products, but other company products. So they are seeing, oh, today all of us are buying like this. And people who are buying our products are also buying theirs. So why can't we then simulate ourselves in the outside market? Or let us go from the consumer and see what the consumer is asking for. And let us see how much of it we can need. So it's a constant process of gathering data and information.
information. Data is very, very important today. And so this is what our CRM has evolved. Starting from financial management in the 70s. How I financial management? Because you mainly thought customer relationship is all about good prices. Then it moved to business process redesign, because you wanted in the 80s to have more information about your customer and take feedback, create services or products that the customer felt comfortable with. Then 90s, you found that to do that, you needed resources. You needed people, you needed technology. So 90s were spent in creating these resources. So it came to enterprise resource planning. And from 2000 onwards, all this has been channeled in one direction. So this is how the whole thing has evolved in the 70s. So in 30 years, this is where we arrived. I'll show you a video and then we'll take a break. It's a very simple video, but it very simply explains what we just spoke about.
As a small business owner, you want to win new customers and keep them as long as possible. So how do you turn individual sales into long-term relationships? There are so many opportunities and interactions with each customer, and keeping track of them all can be quite challenging. But there is a great tool to manage your customer communications and customize your marketing efforts to keep customers coming back. It's called Customer Relationship Management, or CRM. Let's see how some companies are making CRM work for them. Johnson Dental is a small practice with about 100 patients. Every Halloween, business spiked, but the rest of the year, things were flat. So when the office manager, Melanie, noticed that they were gaining new patients at a slow rate and repeat appointments were at a minimum, she knew something had to change. Her first solution was to enhance existing patient relationships. After all, existing customers are easier and less expensive to maintain than finding new ones. To Melanie's surprise, this was simpler than she thought. She found she could leverage many of the computer tools she was already using. She just had to change how she used them. For instance, Mel already used Excel spreadsheet and Outlook email and calendar software. These helped her maintain multiple databases on all patients, like contact information, scheduling, payments tracking, but she had no experience doing things like tracking patient trends or integrating patient information in other functions. But it was easy. All she had to do was reuse information she was already collecting. The first thing was combining email addresses with calendar entries. That opened the door to sending email reminders to patients who had missed annual appointments and offer their best patients a free teeth whitening on their birthday. She was embarking on the most basic do-it-yourself CRM, but it worked. Before long, she noticed a spike in patient bookings. On the other side of town, Smith Legal Partners maintains a large clientele. They committed to being the best personal injury litigators in a tri-state area, but growth had peaked out and they wanted more income. Their client management process was more complex. So the founder, Mr. Smith, hired an online CRM services provider. They started by evaluating where things stood in categories like number of clients, volume of billings, man hours spent, and marketing costs. Smith identified goals in terms of what legal department needed to improve and turned the service provider loose to create a direct mail campaign and social networking designed to build awareness for personal injury. Through the CRM program, their mailers contain automated messages customized to prospects and clients, addressing things like recipients' chronic medical conditions or prior arrests. In no time at all, the phone started ringing off the hook, and his lawyers were busier than ever. Meanwhile, the financial planners at Fix Financial Group were having a tough time acquiring and keeping clients due to the poor economy. The president, Mr. Jones, decided that he needed a new way to reach out. He had his IT staff install a software system on internal servers that would contact new and existing clients in dozens of ways. Through this advanced CRM system, Fix was able to link different databases and applications they were using in bookkeeping, records, and communications. Soon, they were uncovering opportunities and tracking leads, referrals, interaction, and responses. Jones reassigned some of his clerical staff to do nothing but contact current clients with new services and send prospects information on new investment opportunities. The system even managed contacts and workflow. By being in charge of its own in-house CRM solution, Fix was sure to have the scalability to grow and the flexibility to incorporate things like mobile access so that they could have fully informed conversations with customers and prospects on the road. This helped business greatly and portfolio values soared. But how could all three companies put a value on their CRM and all other marketing efforts to improve business? It's a critical step to measure and monitor the results each marketing campaign generates. All three companies decided to measure the performance of their marketing, each in a different way. Johnson Dental's manual do-it-yourself CRM was small enough that they could gauge effectiveness in their bookings. That told them how they were handling existing patients through their email efforts. Mel had also sent mailers with business reply cards, or BRCs, to potential patients, making it easy for prospects to respond to certain offers. The reply cards contained different coupon codes per promotion, which helped to identify the offer they were responding to. This not only helped build the volume of initial exams, but it helped to know what dental services people are trending to, like teeth whitening. To get a little more technical, Smith Law, who is using online providers for CRM, decided to use automated services to measure performance of some of their web-based marketing campaigns. Using online tools like Omniture and Google Analytics, Smith was able to measure which marketing effort worked best by analyzing pages from their website. Metrics showed things like the number of online visitors they were drawing, the path each one took through the website, and which pages were viewed. He could even see in search engine rankings how well their efforts were paying off. Smith also created special web pages with their own URL for responses to individual promotions like free divorce seminars and prenuptial negotiation. In no time, seminars were so popular they had to add extra sessions, and new clients were walking in the door, although usually at different times. Fix Financial, with their in-house process, created the most elaborate tracking system of all. They used their IT department to write their own system that tracked metrics, including prospect inquiries, new customers, account setups, online registrations, and account history. Since a lot of the customers were coming from all over the state, Fix implemented a different toll-free 800 number for each promotion. After about a week, they found they should be setting up a branch office in the next town for tax consulting. Being able to interpret how each marketing effort was paying off for these three companies helped bring down the cost of doing business. It led to a better understanding of the cost per new prospect converted or transaction completed of each campaign. They knew the value of referrals and could actually put a price on overall customer satisfaction. Over time, each company was able to improve planning, cut costs, and streamline day-to-day operations, simply by knowing more about how their efforts at reaching the customers were working.
For more detailed resources, like brochures and white paper.
Small businesses also benefit from customer relationship management, example. And there are many things we are doing.